past week, the baseball world was saddened with the death of one of its mascots, basically Yogi Berra. And Yogi Berra had a big influence on not only baseball, but culture. So many phrases that he said have been remembered. You know, it ain't over till it's over. When you come to a fork in the road, pick it up. The future ain't what it used to be. You know, just all kinds of Yogi Berraisms that infected our culture. It reminded me of the fact that many of us look at scriptures kind of like that. We know God so loved the world, he gave his only son. We know a few verses here and there, but we've never known how the whole story fits together. And that's been the focus of this series called The Epic Story, to try to condense the Bible down into seven significant themes, seven significant time periods and even movements within scripture, that if we could really see that picture, we now understand how everything else fits into the Bible. And for many of us, it's been kind of an eye-opening experience. And today's the midpoint. Today's the number four out of the seven messages. We've looked at first creation. That God made everything. Everything begins with God, therefore everything belongs to God, especially us. But we find out through the very first couple that was made, Adam and Eve, that they were given this test to trust God. They could have anything they wanted in the garden except to leave alone the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And yet they were drawn to it. They heard the whispers of the serpent. They took of that fruit and they ate it, and they were banished from the garden, and they became corrupt, and so did their children and the generations that followed, leading up to the time of Noah, when God brought judgment upon the earth through a flood and basically wiped out humanity except for one family. He began to rebuild through them. And God made a promise to Noah, what's called a covenant. And we learned last week about covenants, and the one with Noah was first that God would never flood the earth as an act of judgment again, that the sign of the rainbow reminds us of that, but the most significant covenant in the Old Testament was a covenant with Abraham. God made a promise to Abraham that he would build a nation from his offspring, a nation as numerous as stars in the sky, as sand on the seashore, and out of this nation would come one who would then become the blessing to all the nations upon the earth. And we learn that through Abraham, that God saw within him this quality that he desires of all people, this quality of faith. That Abraham simply said, God, I'll do what you told me to do. And God said, get up and leave, he left. And when he finally had a little boy, this son of the promise, Isaac, we don't know how old he was, but God told him to sacrifice him. And Abraham struggled, but he went to sacrifice his son, and then God said, no, you don't need to do it, you passed the test. And he became a model for all of us of what it means to trust God, to trust and obey him. And God hoped that his offspring would do that, and through Isaac, and then Isaac's son Jacob, and God renamed Jacob Israel, and his sons became the tribes of Israel. They were to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, set apart from him, a witness to all the other nations in the world that there is one true God, the God who protects, the God who provides, the God who listens. He was their God, and they were to display his presence in their midst to all the nations so that they would be drawn to him, but they struggled to do that. And we're going to learn a lot about that today. But in that struggle to do that, God was faithful to his promise. And he raised up through one of those sons of Jacob, the tribe of Judah, a man named David. And God told David that one of his offspring would become a king who would reign forever. And so generation after generation, we come down the line to the New Testament where the Bible says that there came a man named Joseph from the line of David who was pledged to be married to a woman named Mary who was with child. And that child would be different than any other child who's been born. He would be called Jesus, for he would save his people from their sins. Well, today we're going to look at basically the Bible from Exodus through the rest of the Old Testament to look at how the people prepared for the coming of Jesus, how they lived in this covenant relationship with God. And what you're going to find is there's just a simple pattern, a sad pattern, that's chronicled from Exodus to the end of the Old Testament. It repeats over and over and over again. So really, today's message is very simple. Even though this is the longest section of Scripture covered in all the messages, I mean, Exodus through Malachi, it's a lot of ground we're covering. There really is one basic message. And it is to trust in God, to follow him, to do what he says. God will bless you when you live in covenant with him. But many of us, like the people in the Old Testament, will find ourselves drawn away from that. We'll find it difficult to be faithful to our God. And there are some of you today who today's message, out of all the messages, is the one you need to hear, because there's a warning in today's message, a warning and an invitation to make a change so that we can be in that place of blessing, the place of favor, the place of receiving God's goodness to us. So let's begin just by asking God to speak to us, to soften our hearts, and to help us to know His will for our lives. So Father, we come before You humbly. We come before You openly. Would You speak to us through Your word, Father? Draw us to, give us a greater vision of how much You love us, how committed You are to us. And may we leave this place today more committed to You, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to pick up the story toward the end of the book of Genesis. Of the sons of Jacob was one named Joseph, who was his father's favorite. And Joseph ended up becoming a sore spot with his brothers. They actually kidnapped him and planned to kill him, but instead of killing him, were persuaded to sell him as a slave to some Egyptians who happened to be caravanning by. And Joseph goes to Egypt and becomes a servant in Potiphar's household. Now, there's a whole incredible story of how Joseph gets misjudged, thrown in prison. He interprets dreams. He gets placed as Pharaoh's right-hand man, and he becomes an administrator over Egypt during a time of prosperity and a time of drought. And it's during this time of drought that all of the other brothers who don't know he's alive, they move to Egypt because that's where the grain is. And it's during that period of time they're reunited with their brother, and God looks at the whole situation and says, what you intended for harm, God intended for good. So here they are in Egypt, and the nation of Israel is all gathered there. And we turn to the book of Exodus to pick up the story. In Exodus chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, it says, now Joseph and his brothers and all that generation died, but the Israelites were exceedingly fruitful. They multiplied greatly, increased in numbers, and became so numerous that the land was filled with them. God is fulfilling His promise to multiply. They're very fertile. They're very productive. And there's little Israelites running around all over the place. So much so that when the new Pharaoh comes into power, he's a little concerned. There's like too many of them. And if they would enforce turn against me, they would demolish us. And so I've got to rein them in. So here's how he reined them in. He conscripted them to labor, hard labor, to build their cities and to work their fields. And this went on for many generations, over 400 years. It was during this period of time that the Israelites are suffering and they're crying out to God. God raises up a man named Moses. And Moses is used by God to bring His people out of Egypt. And if you know the story, there's a miracle of the splitting of the Red Sea and the Israelites marching through to get to the wilderness, the sea collapsing on the Egyptian army, washing them under, and the Israelites find themselves in this new place. Now, they draw near to the edge of the land that God had promised in the promise to Abraham to take them to, the promised land, the land of Canaan, the land that's very lush, the land that's very fruitful, and God's planning to give it to them. The only problem is it's already inhabited by other people who worship other gods. And so they're at this place, and they send some spies into the land on a reconnaissance mission. And as they're in the land, they're exploring it, and they come back with a mixed report. 10 of the spies are afraid. They know that there's lush produce there, but they're intimidated by the tall people. They seem to be well-equipped, well-armed warriors for battle, and they don't think they can take them on and defeat them. But two of the spies, Joshua and Caleb, are men who believe that the same God who delivered us from Egypt will deliver those people into our hands. And yet the 10 spies gather a lot of followers, and pretty soon this negative perspective spreads among all of Israel, and they don't want to go forward. They want to stay right where they are. And so we pick up in Numbers chapter 14, starting with the first verse. That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose a leader, go back to Egypt. And Moses and Aaron fell face down in front of the whole Israelite assembly, gathered there, Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite assembly, I mean, these guys are pleading with them, the land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. Remember the Garden of Eden? God saw that it was good. This is like paradise again for our people. This is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and he will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. But the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Once again, God's people brought to a place of testing. Will you trust God? Will you not look at the fear around you, but trust God, the God who brought you through the Red Sea to here? Will you trust that God? And trust that he's good? And trust that he's powerful? Or are you going to take things in your own hands? And they decide, we'd rather trust in what we see than in what we don't see. And here's the theme you're going to see again and again, all through Scripture. Trust and obey, or a price you will pay. Trust and obey. Follow God. Trust him. Go where he's leading you, or there will be consequences. You will suffer the loss of God's exceedingly good blessing. Trust and obey him. He's brought you this far. He'll take you the rest of the way. When you are in a covenant with God, he promises to be your guide, your protector, your warrior, your comfort. But he says, you've got to trust me, even when it's difficult. Now, I think we get that as parents. We make all kinds of requests and set rules for our kids. Things like brushing your teeth, when you should go to bed, who you can hang around, you know, the kind of things that we think are dangerous to stay away from, do your chores, say your prayers, all these kind of things we give to our kids. And in essence, we're telling our kids, I know better than you. I see the bigger picture, you don't. Down the road, you'll thank me for this. So trust us. Trust mom and dad with this one. And so what do kids do? You know, they argue, they fight, you know, I don't need to do that, I don't like that, I think I've got a better plan for my life. And really what we're telling our kids is trust us. Just trust us. Do what we're telling you to do because we see the whole thing. We've been there before. And that's the way God is with his children. God is saying to us constantly, trust me. Trust what I say is good. And yet we're saying, but God, I don't know. I don't know if that's going to work out. I don't know if I should do it that way. You know, I'm looking at it and I can't see the end. And God says, trust me with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. I will be with you. I will guide you. So God gave his children commandments to obey to show them they trusted him. He started off saying, I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. You shall have no other gods before me. Don't make any graven images. Keep my name and the Sabbath day as very sacred in your life. Honor your relationships with your parents, with your spouse. Honor your possessions and the possessions of other people. Keep your word. He gave them dietary laws, things that they could eat and things they shouldn't eat because they really weren't healthy for them. And all during this time, God tells them to trust him. See, because they didn't listen to Joshua and Caleb, they wandered for 40 years in the desert. And one of the consequences was not a single man was allowed to enter the promised land 40 years later, except for the two who trusted God, Joshua and Caleb. But all through this time, God shows his grace. See, God is a God of second chances. He says, I want to teach you how to trust. So here's what God did. He says, I'm going to provide you a food called manna. And every day when you wake up, you go gather this manna. And I don't know, manna to me was like cornflakes, sugar frosted cornflakes. And they gather this up every day. You'd gather enough, and that's what you'd eat for that day. And you did that every day. But when it came to Saturday, which was the Sabbath, they were not to go out because it wouldn't be good. It would spoil. God cursed the food on that day. He says, you trust me on that day. You'll have enough to gather on the day before, on Friday, that'll carry you over 2 days. And you know what? For 40 years, God fed them that way. And the greater lesson was this, because it says it in the Bible, God did this to test them, to show that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So it wasn't a message about just food. It was a message about your life. Trust what God says. That's the kind of God I am to you. I will bless you. I will protect you. I will provide for you. I'll do exceedingly good things for you. Just trust me. And yet they struggled to trust God. As they came into the promised land, God used Joshua to march them in, and they had wars to fight, and they had to march around the city of Jericho and different things like that. But when they finally get into the land, Joshua renews their covenant with the Lord, and he recounts what God had done for them. And then in verse 14 of Joshua 24, he tells them this. This is this challenge. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshiped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me, my household, we're going to serve the Lord. He said, you've been influenced a lot. You've had all these things happen in your life, and God, your parents and your grandparents used to worship. And you've got influences from the culture right around us, right here. And you have a choice. Which of those gods are you going to serve? Because I'm telling you what God I'm going to serve. And what God my family's going to serve. And the people responded and said, oh, we love God and we're going to serve God. And he said, consider what you're saying. This is a big commitment you're making. And they committed themselves to following the Lord. And you know what? They did. All during Joshua's lifetime, they followed the Lord until Joshua died. Until Joshua died. Now, during this time, this crowd and creep of gods is coming around them. And I want to pause right here to reflect of how many of us have grown up in environments. It might be your family. It might be the neighborhood. It definitely is the culture that there are gods all around us. What is a god? Is it a statue? Is it the sun? Is it the moon? What is a god? You can make anything a god. It's anything you put in the place of God to give you what only God can give you. Things like deep joy, purpose, guidance and direction, significance. They come from God. When you start looking to other things, for example, people look to possessions, a house, that car, that ring. It becomes a god. Some people look at achievement, recognition, a title. Is that what makes them important? That becomes a god. When your body is toned and tanned, it can become your god. A relationship can become a god, a boyfriend, a wife, a baby or grandchild. When that person starts becoming, person or thing comes between you and God to give you what only God can truly give you, it has become a god. And when you put hope in that thing, you end up disappointed, depressed, and desperate. I mean, think of advertising in our culture and what they advertise to. Our advertisers are appealing to the God search within us. I mean, if you get this toothpaste, if you do this exercise program, if you buy this male enhancement drug, you get this car, it'll give you what God's failed to give you. And it'll meet all your needs. We go, wow, God's good, but this is even better. But then we get that thing, and we try that thing, and it never delivers on the promise. That's the lure of the false gods all around us. I like what Kyle Eidelman says, that idolatry isn't just one of many sins. Rather, it's the one great sin from which all other sins come. See, God is jealous. He won't share us with anyone. That's why he says, you should have no other gods before me. It's not as if God said, put me at the top of the list of all your gods. I'm the best one. I'm the best of all your gods. He says, no, no, no. I'm the only God. And I prove myself by delivering you. You shall have no other gods in view of me. Because there's no other gods that are real. God makes that declaration. Why? Is God ego-driven? Is God selfish? No, God's passionate. Can you imagine any husband in this room You are jealous of your wife. You don't want anything come between you and your wife, and you will fight for her. And you'll get angry at someone who tries to come between the two of you. That's a strong, powerful love. That's the kind of love God has for us. He will not share us with anybody else. Not because he's petty, but because he's passionate. God loves us so much. And so he says, get rid of the gods of your ancestors. Get rid of the gods of the culture and make the decision for you and your family. You will serve the true living God. But here's what happens. Joshua dies, and the leaders that served with him die. We come to Judges chapter 2, and there's a summary of a change in the culture. It says, after that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals, the false gods. They forsook the Lord, the God of their ancestors, who had brought them out of Egypt. Notice they always go back. The God who did this for you. They've abandoned him. They followed and worshiped various gods of the peoples around them. They aroused the Lord's anger because they forsook him and served Baal and the Ashtoreths. In his anger against Israel, the Lord gave them into the hands of raiders who plundered them. He sold them into the hands of their enemies all around, whom they were no longer able to resist. Now, why did God do that? To get them to a place of desperation where they'd cry out for him again. And so that's what they would end up doing. But whenever Israel went out to fight, the hand of the Lord was against them to defeat them. Just as he had sworn to them, they were in great distress. But then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of the raiders. Yet they would not listen to their judges, but prostituted themselves to other gods and worshiped them. They quickly turned from the ways of their ancestors who had been obedient to the Lord's command. Whenever the Lord raised up a judge for them, he was with the judge and saved them out of the hands of their enemies as long as the judge lived. For the Lord relented because of their groaning under those who oppressed and afflicted them. But when the judge died, the people returned to ways even more corrupt than those of their ancestors, following other gods and serving and worshiping them. They refused to give up their evil practices and stubborn ways. Joshua and all those leaders die, and it says another generation grew up who neither knew the Lord or what he had done for Israel. And I'm just struck by that, saying, how did that happen? Whose responsibility was it to teach the next generation? Who failed? Well, one was their parents. How could these kids grow up and never hear the great stories of what God had done? How did they not get introduced to a relationship with the Lord? Somebody dropped the big ball. And then we have the whole community, the kind of the Old Testament church community. Are they not doing this too? See, faith is not picked up by osmosis. It's not just picked up by being around Christian people. It has to be intentionally passed on to the next generation. That's why God told his people, when your kids get up, when they walk along the road, when they gather around the dinner table, when you put them to bed at night, tell them about me. Put signs and things in your house, on the door frames, in the walls. Let your kids know what God has done for you. Be sure to tell them the great things God has done. They must have failed to do that because none of these kids grew up with a devotion to the Lord. How quick a generation can be lost by the failure of us adults who know the Lord if we don't intentionally, regularly pass on that faith to our kids. They will be drifting to the gods of the culture. That's what happened here. They drifted. They fell away from the Lord, and they lost his blessing. When our kids don't stand for anything, they'll fall for everything. And what happened to this nation of Israel as they progressed through time, they looked to the other nations around and says, we want to be more like them. In fact, we need a king, they said. Like all the other nations, a king, a man in power who will lead us. And they were warned by a prophet who said, you already have a king. His name is the Lord God. He's been a good king. He's been a strong king. He's been an undefeated king. Why would you want any other king? He said, well, we want to be like everybody else. We want a king we can see sitting on a throne in a palace. And God said there'll be consequences for that. There'll be severe consequences, but I'll give you what you crave. So he gave them a man named Saul, who quickly became corrupt and abused his power. And he was followed by David, who did some really good things, but even David had struggles with his own sin. And then David was followed by Solomon, who was the wisest man who ever lived. But as Solomon began to marry other women from other nations, he began to worship their gods and drift from the one true God. By the time Solomon has children, the kingdom gets split in half. And 10 of the tribes become known as the northern tribes. They're called Israel. And the remaining tribes form around the one key tribe of that named Judah. And Judah continues to worship around Jerusalem and keep the system, even though they do it imperfectly. But the ones on the north, they make Samaria their capital city. They raise up their own set of priests, no longer the priests of Levi. They have their own priests. And they began to integrate the gods in the worship of the cultures around them. Over the course of time, they drift further and further from God. There's 20 kings that serve over Israel. The Bible says of every single king, he did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Every single one of them. What about the kings of Judah? There was 20 kings of Judah. Almost every one did evil in the eyes of the Lord too. There were a few shining examples, a Josiah, a Hezekiah, a Jehoshaphat. And in their stories, you find glimmers of hope and truth. But even those men oftentimes end up reverting in their older years to a place of not trusting God. They failed to trust and obey. There was a price to pay, and that price was paid by God bringing judgment to them by the nations around them. The northern tribes in 722 BC were taken by Assyria. And they were absorbed into Assyria so much that they are called the 10 lost tribes. They lost their identity. They had no central focus. And they just were integrated into the people. And in Jesus' day, whenever they looked at those people from Samaria, that was not a compliment. It was a sign that you were a people who abandoned God and linked arms with another culture. There's a description of why this happened, why the nation of Israel was allowed to go this direction. And we read it in 2 Kings chapter 17. It says, all this took place because the Israelites had sinned against the Lord their God, who had brought them out of Egypt and from under the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. We go down to verse 11. At every high place they burned incense, as the nations whom the Lord had driven out before them had done. So rather than win the nations, they conformed to the nations. They did wicked things and aroused the Lord's anger. They worshiped idols, though the Lord had said, you shall not do this. The Lord warned Israel and Judah through his prophets and seers, turn from your evil ways, observe my commands and decrees, in accordance with the entire law that I commanded your ancestors to obey, that I delivered to you through my servants, the prophets. But they would not listen and were as stiff-necked as their ancestors, who did not trust in the Lord their God. They rejected his decrees and the covenant he had made with their ancestors and the statutes he had warned them to keep. They followed worthless idols and themselves became worthless. They imitated the nations around them, although the Lord had ordered them, do not do as they do. They just failed to trust and obey. And the price they paid was captivity to Assyria. And it didn't just happen to the northern tribes. The southern tribe of Judah was taken in around 605 BC by Babylonians. Now, a portion of them had been taken by Egypt, but the Babylonians came on, not only took Egypt, but the rest of Judah. And they took portions of them that they transported into Babylon, the cream of the crop. Some very key men who they wanted to integrate it into their political system and in their military ranks. One of those men you'll know as Daniel. Daniel gets taken to Babylon, but Daniel will not let go of his faith in the true God. And those that are taken to Babylon actually maintain their identity. 70 years later, Babylon is defeated by Persia, and the Persian king Cyrus releases the Israelites to go back home. And so under Nehemiah, they begin to rebuild the city of Jerusalem, rebuild the walls around that place. Ezra comes and begins to teach people the scriptures so they can get anchored again in their faith. But never again does it become this powerful theocracy that they had years before. And this goes on through the Old Testament period. this image of people who've wandered, who've suffered, who've disobeyed God, and yet God gives them chances again and again and again, second, third, fourth, fifth chances. He speaks to them through prophets, telling them, turn of your ways, turn back to me. I'm the God you can trust. And yet they're so stubborn, so stiff-necked. And amazingly, God is faithful in his promise to them. So he speaks through all these prophets, and there's some called major prophets. They're usually the big chapters of the big sections of the Bible, Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, and then there are minor prophets, these little short books. And one of the minor prophets is a man named Hosea. And God says to Hosea, I want you to marry a woman, and her name is Gomer. I mean, what? That's already you're off to a bad start. My girlfriend, yeah, Gomer, she's cool. She wasn't really cool because she had a wandering eye. And even though they have children together, Gomer prostitutes herself with other men. And God tells Hosea, go tell her how much you love her. Go tell her how much you're committed to her. And deep inside we're thinking, get away from that woman. She's unfaithful to you. And God says, Hosea, keep going. Keep loving her in spite of the fact that she's sleeping around with other men, because that's what my people Israel are doing. They're committing spiritual adultery on me. They're worshiping other gods, but I love them. And listen to this. Hosea chapter 2, verse 14. God says this. Therefore, I am now going to allure her. Speaking of Israel. I will lead her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. Did they deserve it? Absolutely not. They deserve judgment. They deserve punishment. And God says, I'm going to keep trying. I'm going to keep trying to win her over. And that's why the Bible says God's kindness leads us to repentance. I don't know what kind of church you grew up in. Sometimes we've heard that God's this angry God and God's going to smash you to smithereens if you don't trust him. But I see God as this loving husband who's pleading, doing everything he can. Sometimes God allows us to be taken away, to suffer consequences, so we would fall to our knees and again turn back to him. And so Ezekiel comes along and God says to Ezekiel, look at that field. Ezekiel says, it's a bunch of bones. It's a boneyard. Bones everywhere. And God says, that's right. Preach to the bones. So he begins to preach to the bones, and this miracle happens. Bone upon bone starts to come together, and it's like the skeleton gets reassembled. And there's tendons, and there's ligaments, and there's flesh that covers these bones, and they're still lifeless. So God breathes into them, and they come to life. And he tells Ezekiel, that's what I'll do with my people. They're dead. They're dead and gone. They can't resurrect themselves, but I will do that. I will raise them up. I will put my spirit in them, and they will live. And he's speaking of a time coming when the Holy Spirit will be given to enable us to do something that people never before in history could do, to be driven from a power inside to follow and trust God. And so these people who are dead, who've wandered, and learned the hard lesson that if you don't trust and obey, there'll be a price to pay. God says, I'm going to raise one up. And before I can send my spirit, he must reign on this earth and he must die. He's going to be a little child. And Isaiah says this, the virgin will be with the child. And he describes this child in Isaiah chapter 9. You've heard it at Christmas time oftentimes. Here's what the scripture says from Isaiah. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. He's coming. You don't deserve him, yet he still wants to be your king, and he wants to reign over your heart. Now I want to ask you, as I was looking through this Old Testament pattern, it amazed me that these people would drift from God after God had done things like save them out of Egypt. How could they ever turn from God? And yet, I've known people who God has saved. I've watched people come out of that baptistry with great joy, and I've watched them drift away from the church and from God. And I'm amazed, like, how could you experience that? And then I thought, how we're no different than those people in the Old Testament. If we don't trust in the Lord, follow the leading of the Holy Spirit in our lives, how quickly we can drift from God. In fact, drifting is such a danger for all of us. The culture around us offers us many gods, and they begin to pull us away. And for many of us, we would say, well, I know Jesus is still God. But here's where you've compromised. You've said, but there are some other gods who sure can accompany Jesus in my life, to fill in where Jesus has lacked. And the danger is there is no room for two gods. You can only serve one or the other. See, I can drift and you can drift. And here are some of the signs of a spiritual drift. Number one is you have little or no passion for worship. You find yourself mouthing songs, but there's not an overflow from the heart that just is bursting forth. That's a danger sign. It's real dangerous. It's dangerous when you have a little eagerness to read your Bible and pray. You'll do it more out of guilt or responsibility than joy, but there's not a real hunger there. You're not craving to spend time with God and talk to him in prayer and hear what he has to say through his word. If you aren't hungering for that, I'd start waving that red flag. Say, there's a danger here. Something's not right. When you distance yourself from fellowship, when you start to become critical of God's people to the point of, I don't like being around Christians because they're hypocrites. So I'm going to hang around people that don't go to church, who don't profess a love for God, because I actually enjoy their company better. They're nicer people. But here's what you don't see. Those people do not have a goal in their life to honor God. Those people do not have a goal in their life to push you closer to your Lord. And the longer you stay with them and the further you stay from your Christian people, as imperfect as they are, you'll find yourself drifting from God. God made the church. These are his people, as imperfect as they are, and as imperfect as you are. We are sinners all searching to find Jesus in a greater way. Here's something else that happens. You don't feel a need to lead people to Christ. Why? Because if you like people outside the church better than you like people inside the church, why in the world will you try to bring them to Christ and become part of the unloved people? So you kind of accept them where they are. In fact, you start to justify that maybe they're okay where they are, and maybe the gods they have are sufficient for them. That's a place of danger in your life, because there's only one true God who delivers people. When you find yourself standing up to God more than surrendering to him, that's a dangerous place to be. When things don't go right in your life, when you have questions, when you have hurts, and you start arguing with God, demanding that God do things your way, I find that to be a very dangerous place. Here's a much better response. When you don't understand what's happening in your life, to be broken before the Lord, to say, God, I still trust you, even when I don't get it. Even when I don't understand it, I still trust you. Why fight against the God who wants to direct and guide and bless you? And be puffed up with a pride that says, I know better than God? It's not a good place to be. It's not a place of blessing. And finally, you become blind to your own sin. You just don't see it. You've justified it for so long that you start to drift and you get to a place where eventually it is almost impossible to return. Several years ago, our family was on vacation. Our kids were little. They're sitting in the back of our Ford Bronco, driving through Kansas. There was a rainstorm, and my wife was sleeping in the passenger seat. I decided to take a quick way home, and I made a turn on a road I should have made a turn on, and I realized real quickly this wasn't a good turn. In fact, it was a narrow road, only a two-lane road, no shoulder on either side, and I had a choice either to drive this road down to a nature reserve, which was a preserve, about 2 miles down the road and turn there, or I could do the guy thing and just make it work right here. I'm just going to turn it around right here. Now, the Ford Bronco had terrible turning radius, so I knew I'd have to kind of turn it back up, and do that. So my first move was, I'm just going to go off the road a little bit. Just the two tires on the right side, go off the road, get enough room that I can start to turn. But here was the problem, because it was raining so hard, and there was a muddy shoulder in the road slope, that as soon as these big tires got in the mud, they just began to spin, and not only spin, but they started to pull the Bronco off the road. And so when I even went faster, it was like, ooh, we're sliding off. We could end up rolling over. I say we. My family's sleeping. But I decided I better wake my wife up, and she'll be really happy. Say, honey, I need you to move in the driver's seat, because I'm going to go outside, and Hulk here is going to try to push the Bronco back onto the road while you're moving it forward. And that was so stupid. I could not budge that thing. And as she moved forward, we actually slid more down this slope. And then I just said, stop. I got back in the driver's seat, sat there for a minute, and the kids are awake now. So, Dad, what are you going to do? I had no answer. I'm humiliated. I'm speechless. And then I do the pastor card. We need to pray. Okay, we just need to pray. So yeah, Dad, pray. So I'm praying, and I'm inside, I'm really praying, God, save me from this mess. And you know what happens within a minute after that prayer? A truck comes by. It's a county truck with a guy who works at that nature preserve. He says, hey, I got a chain here, and you guys need to be pulled out. I said, hallelujah, yes, we do. And he pulled us out, turned that thing around, got back on the road on the way home. And I was so grateful that God heard my prayer. But I reflected on how our spiritual lives are like that. We get in a mess. We start to slide. We think, I can fix it. I'm not too far away. I can handle this. I know what I'm doing. And all you do is keep sliding, keep sliding. The more you try to fix it, the more you slide until you get to the place where all you can do is cry out to God, deliver me. God, I got screwed up. I don't know how I got to where I am, but I just screwed up so bad. I don't know what to do. And God's gracious. I can't believe that God comes back again and again, gives us a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance, and says, I love you so much. I'll reach out to you. The book of Isaiah pictures us like this. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us have turned to his own way. We're like dumb sheep. We're prone to wander. We're prone to wander. But here's what God has done. God says, you're bad sheep, that there's a good sheep. And here's what God did to this good sheep. It says in Isaiah 53, the last part of that verse, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And it goes on to say that Jesus was led like a lamb to the slaughter, that he was wounded for our transgressions, that though we wander, he suffered. So understand this. There was a price paid for the failure to trust and obey, and it was paid by Jesus at the cross. He didn't have to do that. Why did he do it? Because like a loving husband, he's trying to lure you back to his grace because he wants to give you good things. He has an exceedingly good future for you. But you've got to trust him. You've got to obey him to live in that place of blessing in your relationship with him. And I'll just be real honest. I think a lot of us in this room have been straying, have been wandering. And we find ourselves losing that love for God and passion for Scripture and love for fellowship. And we come to church once a month or twice a month. And, you know, we just don't have that passion and fire. And God's saying, is there anyone else? Look what I've done. I'm the God who delivered you.
Well, thanks for watching and listening online today. We really hope that as we continue this journey through the epic story, that you learn that the Bible is more than just a collection of tales and stories, but it's actually one continuous narrative about the person of Jesus Christ. And we hope that you can learn how you fit within that story and what your life means in the context of Scripture. If you've made a decision today based on today's message, whether it's you just need some prayer or you want to get baptized or you just have a question or maybe you want to meet Jesus for the first time in your life, then we want to be able to pray for you and walk through that journey with you. So there's a couple of ways that you can do this. One, you can download our app. It's free from the iTunes and Google Play App Store. Just search for Pikes Peak Christian Church. Then just click the prayer request button and fill that out and let us know how we can pray for you. And if you would like us to contact you, we'd be happy to do that as well. You can also go onto our website at pikespeakchristian.org and contact us there. Again, let us walk through this journey with you. While you're on the app or the website, if you'd like, you can check out upcoming events that are happening at the church and ways that you can connect. And if you'd like to support the ministry of Pikes Peak Christian Church, you can give online there as well. Well, we hope to see you back next week. I hope that you tune in for the next installment of the Epic Story series. Thank you so much, and God bless.